Excellent. Thanks so much. So first of all, I'd like to thank the conference organizers, Dr. Coleman, Nivisky, and Dr. Rossi for the kind introduction and welcome and invitation. So great meeting. And so coming from Houston, it's nice to get some cold weather because it's still 80s and 90s as of last week. So this is a nice change for me. So over the next kind of 20 minutes, I really want to focus on high-risk myeloma. And as we get into it a bit more, really define what is high-risk myeloma, how do we define it, a couple of practical tips as we approach high-risk myeloma, and then potential therapeutic options in this setting. And so, you know, I think when we start talking about high-risk myeloma, we tend to have this very laser focus at the time of diagnosis, trying to identify these patients with high-risk myeloma. And we'll look at patients with, for example, ISS stage, gene expression profiling, or cytogenetics, to identify these patients at a time of diagnosis to look for high-risk myeloma. And then we look at treatment and then outcomes, and these patients tend to have a short overall survival. And I think what we don't want to forget, and I'll highlight this as we move along, is that during treatment itself, we can identify patients with high-risk myeloma as well, because we know that the factors that we look at with ISS stage or cytogenetics are not perfect. And so we can still identify patients as we go along in treatment. And so don't forget those patients who have an early relapse or an aggressive relapse. And so I mean those patients who are relapsing less than 1 year post-transplant who may just be ISS stage one without normal cytogenetics. So I think you still want to identify those patients with early relapse or aggressive relapse. And also we'll talk a bit more about CNS presentations, extramedullary disease, and plasma cell leukemia, because these are all markers of high-risk disease, which may not be picked up with at time of diagnosis. And so just briefly going over at time of diagnosis, one of our main risk factors for symptomatic myeloma and high-risk disease is ISS stage 3. And so we know that patients with ISS stage 3 disease tend to have an overall survival of 29 months historically, and even with the era of novel therapy, that overall survival is still 40 months and quite short. There are additional risk factors you need to keep in mind as well. So LDH is one that you need to keep an eye on for. So in this, we look at both patients with ISS stage 2 and ISS stage 3 disease. And you'll see even in ISS stage 2 disease, those patients with a high LDH greater than 300 still have a differentiated outcome with a shorter overall survival compared to those with normal LDH. So it can be a helpful differentiator in addition to our ISS stage. And finally, when we look at cytogenetics and FISH studies, we know there's a number of these that are well established now, and I think we're all comfortable with, including deletion 17P, translocation 414, 1416, and 1420. I think as you move forward, we're going to just start seeing additional markers that you need to keep an eye out for. That includes 1P deletions and 1Q21 amplification. So some emerging data about both of these, some conflicting data about this, and we'll see 1Q21 potentially seen in approximately 40 to 50% of patients. I think it's still a little bit debatable about chromosome 1 abnormalities, but I think over the next year, you'll see more emerging data that will support these as potentially high-risk markers. So as we move forward now, I think one key piece of information that I want you to take away from here is really the revised ISS stage. And so this was just came out in JCO in August of this year. So just in the last few months, I think this is important for all of our practices. And so what they did here is look at patients with ISS stage 1, 2, or 3, and they identified really two things. One is cytogenetics by FISH, so a high risk is patients with deletion 17P, 414, or 1416. And then high LDH or normal LDH. And what they did in this revised ISS is patients with ISS stage 3 disease with high-risk cytogenetics or a high LDH were revised ISS stage 3. ISS stage 1 is patients with ISS stage 1 without any other standard risk cytogenetics, and everybody else is stage 2. And what you can see here is the survival curves. And you'll see with revised ISS stage 1, the median overall survival has not been reached. ISS stage 2 is 83 months, and ISS stage 3 with revised is 40 months. And so you'll see when we incorporate LDH and cytogenetics, this can be very helpful as we move forward. Now, importantly, we know that outcomes are not just based on initial risk factors, but also upon the therapies that we use. So in this slide, we'll look at patients in the top, in A, this is patients who had non-transplant. So this is the same revised ISS stage criteria, but this is patients without a transplant, with a transplant, those with IMiD-based therapy or with proteasome inhibitor-based therapy. And so you can see, really, despite the different therapies, that this tends to hold true despite the different therapies. And so this revised ISA stage really continues to differentiate patient outcomes. Unfortunately, this revised ISA stage still has limitations. And so just going through a couple of them. One, this is really pooled data from 3,000 patients from about 10 or 11 randomized clinical trials. So this is, again, not real-world patients who are not healthy enough to be on trials and are not our frail patients. In fact, 65% of these patients in this database were less than 65, and we, in fact, know the majority of our patients are above 70 and 75, so you know, applicability to the real world, I think, is challenging. Finally, this also excluded patients with chromosome 1 abnormalities. As we discussed, there's evolving data around this that may support that this is high risk, so we've excluded that specific risk factor. Finally, we did not look at any host-related factors in this revised ISS stage, which is critically important to looking at patients' age, performance status, comorbidities, hypertension, diabetes, renal or cardiac dysfunction. We're not incorporating into this. And finally, I think anytime you have any type of risk factor, you need to have a test phase and a validation group. And unfortunately, there's no validation of this in an independent data set. So I think we'll see this over the next few years, but I think these are important limitations as we move forward. And so again, this comes back to what I talked about initially, where these ISS stage, cytogenetics, LDH, and even the revised ISS stage really look at a very specific narrow time point at time of diagnosis. And I don't want to get caught in a lull where if you don't see high risk or myeloma patients defined initially, we get caught in a trap of thinking, okay, these are not high risk patients and I can back off. Because in fact, as you go along, you'll start seeing these patients with early relapse and extramedullary disease who also have a poor outcome. And so going through some of this data, if we look at patients with both primary and secondary plasma cell leukemia, and remind you the definition for plasma cell leukemia currently is patients with greater than 20% circulating plasma cells in the periphery or greater than 2 × 10^9 cells in the periphery is an absolute. And so just highlighting, if we look at really, I know this is difficult to see on the top, but we will see is across various different retrospective studies in primary PCL, you'll see that overall survival is going to be typically less than 12 months. And when we look at our experience at MD Anderson for patients with primary plasma cell leukemia, the overall survival is going to be about a year and a half. One thing I just want to highlight here is that we look specifically looking back at the definition of classic definition with greater than 20% circulating plasma cells. And we looked at any CPC, so any circulating plasma cells. So those patients with circulating plasma cells of 2, 3, 4, 5%, 10%, which typically would not be included. And even when we look at those patients, the overall survival is quite short, and it's for primary plasma cell leukemia, 19 months. And if you look at the classic definition, it's 18 months. And again, if you look at secondary plasma cell leukemia, these are all very short, regardless of how you define it, at 6 months. So I think the one tip here is that to continue to look at the differential in these patients, since we look at the CBC and the ANC, and as we filter down, I think that every once in a while we'll miss a circulating plasma cell that we'll see that the pathologist may pick up. So I think it's important to look at this. And similar to AML, anytime you have any blasts in the periphery, that's abnormal. Anytime you have plasma cells in the periphery, that's going to be abnormal. The other high-risk feature that we'll look at from a clinical perspective is CNS disease. And so this really just highlights that patients with CNS involvement typically have a short overall survival of 4 months. And really, regardless of what therapies we use, and really a number of therapies that have been looked at from intrathecal therapy with alone or with systemic therapy, with an auto or allo or cranial XRT, regardless of what we do, we haven't had major advances in the space. And so those patients who present with CNS disease will have an overall survival that's quite short. I think we're all aware of that. Finally, I think here's another key point, and that's those folks that present with extramedullary disease. And so we know if we look at patients from time of relapse, and this is just one example of many, but those patients who present or relapse without extramedullary disease versus those who do will be a significant difference in their overall survival and outcome. And so I think this is critically important as you start looking at patients who start getting extramedullary disease, be it a chest wall mass or a liver lesion or lung lesions, that these patients do tend to have an overall survival that's quite short and will need to be treated quite aggressively. So other evolving predictors, just to highlight a few. So I think one thing we've talked about is really upfront risk factors. We talked about clinical presentations. A couple of the things is really response to therapy. And so I think we'll see this emerging over the next few years. and that's response after initial therapy. So if we're not getting to MRD levels, and so those patients that are still MRD positive, there's going to be a difference in outcomes for those patients. If we look at imaging studies with residual disease with positive PET scans, those can also be predictors of negative outcomes or shorter overall survivals. And so I think the response after therapy is going to be evolving as well as potential markers of shorter overall survival. Finally, don't forget about gene expression profiling. I think that's being more and more incorporated. There's still some challenges with that, but I think that can be very helpful in terms of predicting long-term outcomes as well. A couple of the key points I just want to mention that are not as well described in the literature. And one is sometimes in the pathology report, we'll see blastic or plasmablastic morphology or anaplastic morphology. And so that hasn't been well described, but we've seen that at MD Anderson where patients with myeloma, and if we look at their biopsy reports, the pathologist will describe a plasmablastic morphology. And those patients who also we've looked at will have a shorter overall survival, less than 2 years. We've also looked at CMYC that we'll typically see in Burkitt's lymphoma and other lymphomas. But those patients with CMYC abnormalities and myeloma also have a short overall survival and a short progression-free survival post-transplant. So I think there's some emerging risk factors that we'll be looking at for high-risk myeloma over the next few years. And so now just moving into the next phase, after I identify patients with high risk, how do we treat these patients? So I just really want to go over four of the main therapeutics that we're using now and what we'll be seeing in the next year. And so bortezomib-based therapy, I think, is important. There's been a couple of studies that looked at bortezomib induction therapy. So this IFM 2005 study randomized patients to Velcade-Dex versus VAD as induction therapy prior to transplant. And what you'll see here is that with Velcade-based therapy, they have a CR rate that's quite a bit higher than patients who had VAD-based therapy and really similar to those patients without any high-risk features. The challenge here is that we gave short exposure to bortezomib, and with this, we really saw that with this, we can lead to improved response rates. However, with long-term follow-up, the overall survival is not significantly better. And I think what it highlights here is that short-term therapy is important to overcome the high-risk features, but we need to have really long-term sustained exposure. There was really no impact with bortezomib-based therapy in this study with deletion 17p. And so coming back to initially what I was talking about, so the HOVON group looked at bortezomib both as well as in induction therapy as well as with the maintenance therapy. And in this study here, they compared bortezomib-based therapy compared to VAD. And with RMB, you'll see that when you give long-term bortezomib exposure, you'll see an improvement in outcomes, including in patients with translocation 414 as well as with deletion 17p. And you'll see here improvements in progression-free survival from 12 months to 22 months. So I think that's going to be the key message here. So again, bortezomib, I think, reduces the negative impacts of high risk, specifically translocation 414, to a variable extent with deletion 17. And the key here really is not just short exposure, really to incorporate it as part of consolidation and maintenance and long-term exposure. Finally, we'll talk a little about lenalidomide. So I think the data is challenging with lenalidomide, and there's conflicting data with translocation 414 specifically. And so Donna Reese looked at this with specifically lenalidomide and dexamethasone in relapse disease and really looked at patients with and without translocation 414. And you'll see very similar outcomes, both in progression-free and overall survival. And so maybe lenalidomide impacts and has an outcome that's favorable for translocation 414. However, the IFM group looked at this similarly with lenalidomide and dexamethasone in relapsed refractory myeloma. And again, you'll see the overall response rate for those patients with translocation 414 is 39 versus 62%, and shorter PFS as well as overall survival. And so not clear that lenalidomide overcomes translocation 414. And finally, I think there's really consistent data that there's an unclear benefit in patients with deletion 17p with lenalidomide. So the story changes quite a bit with pomalidomide. And so there's really two pieces of data that I think are helpful. This one study here from Xavier Lulu in the IFM, I think this is important because this is really one of the first prospective study in patients with specifically high-risk disease and not a subset analysis that we've looked at for our previous studies. So in this study, they looked specifically with relapsed myeloma with both either deletion 17P or in translocation 414 with pomalidomide and low-dose dexamethasone. And you'll see that the overall survival was 12 months for deletion 17P and 9.2 months for 414. And similarly, the time to progression was higher for 17P versus 414 of only 2.8 months. And so I think similar to or differentiated from lenalidomide, where it's a variable with translocation 414. Pomalidomide really had no activity in 414. This is the second study that really confirms these findings, and this was the MMO3 study, looking at POM and low-dose dex versus high-dose dex. And what you'll see here is in that all comers, the response rate was 35% with standard risk cytogenetics. If you look at specifically deletion 17P and 414, the response rate was a bit lower, but 25%. Oops. And when you specifically look at standard risk versus high-risk disease, very similar PFS, but then I think the money is right here when you see that deletion 17P patients had a PFS of 4.6 months versus those with translocation 414 only had a PFS of 2.8 months. So I think, again, similar to Xavier Lulu's data, demonstrating that pomalidomide and low-dose dexamethasone has activity in patients with deletion 17P and really no clear benefit in patients with translocation 414. Moving forward with our other novel therapy now with carfilzomib. And again, limited data with carfilzomib, and we'll see this emerging at ASH. And so I really look at two really trials over the last year and really look at subgroup analysis. And so the ASPIRE study, I think we're all familiar with, in relapsed refractory myeloma, randomized patients to carfilzomib RevDex versus RevDex. And this is a positive study showing a significant improvement in progression-free survival. And so we'll see a difference from 17 months to 26 months with KRD versus lenalidomide and dexamethasone. But importantly, and so this was presented at ASCO, and this is really the limited data that we have right now from the ASPIRE study. And when they looked by risk group, by FISH, and identified those patients with high risk with similar or preserved benefit of a 10-month improvement in progression-free survival, from lenalidomide and dex for 13.9 months versus 23 months with carfilzomib, which is similar to what we saw with standard risk disease. So importantly, we're going to see a lot more data at ASH, specifically looking at 17 and 414 and other specific high-risk cohorts. But this is the limited data that we have now suggesting that carfilzomib may have activity in high-risk myeloma. Similarly, we'll look at the ENDEAVOR data. And so this is another randomized phase 3 trial, which I think is potentially practice-changing. In the relapsed refractory setting, which randomized patients to carfilzomib dex versus Velcade dex, so 2 versus 2 head-to-head trial. And so specifically looking at this subgroup, and so approximately 20 to 25% of these patients were high risk by cytogenetics in this. If we look at the overall intent to treat population, we'll see a significant improvement in progression-free survival, and in near doubling from 9.4 months to 18.7 months with carfilzomib. So again, when we look at our subgroup analysis, looking at the bottom here, so we'll look at patients with ISS stage 2 and 3 disease, we'll see that this falls on the side favoring carfilzomib-based therapy. And then again, when we look at risk group with high risk, again, it lands on the side favoring carfilzomib. I think this is critically important because this, I think, and we'll see more data at ASH again with specific cohorts. But again, this starts identifying carfilzomib may further overcome high risk, really compared to what I think is our historical best with bortezomib-based therapy and now potentially pomalidomide. So we're not comparing carfilzomib to dexamethasone or VAD-based therapy, really comparing what I think is an important benchmark. And so even in that setting, we're seeing improved outcomes with carfilzomib. So I think this is very helpful, suggesting that this may be an important option in high-risk myeloma. But I think as we all know that we move into high-risk myeloma, really combination therapy is the key. And so we've seen some nice data now with RVD in high-risk myeloma. And I think there's an important study with carfilzomib and pomalidomide now when we look at combining IMiDs and proteasome inhibitors together. And I think that's going to be really the key when you look at high-risk myeloma. And so this is a phase 1-2 study that we've done with carfilzomib and pomalidomide. And so here, carfilzomib was given in the standard dose twice weekly, days 1, 2, 8, 9, 15, 16, with 27 milligrams per meter squared of carfilzomib and 4 milligrams of pomalidomide. And 79 patients were enrolled in this phase 2 study. And in this, you'll see approximately 22% of these patients will have deletion 17P, 10% at translocation 414, and 7% at 1416. So approximately a quarter of these patients really had high-risk disease. And when we look at responses by risk status, we'll see even the patients with high-risk disease, the overall response rate was 78% compared to those with standard risk, which was 74%. And importantly, it's not just the response rates, as we talked about with high-risk disease. These tend to be durable responses, and so we look at progression-free and overall survival. we'll see that the outcomes are very similar when you look at standard risk versus intermediate and high risk for both progression-free and overall survival. So I think we've talked quite a bit about IMiDs and proteasome inhibitors now. And so this is a slide I've borrowed from Dr. Landgren. And now as we move forward now into the immuno-oncology area, I think this is changing now as well. And so I think there's emerging data here. So I want to spend the last few minutes just highlighting this. And so elotuzumab now has some very nice data from the phase 3, eloquent data that was presented at ASCO. And so just to remind everybody, this is a phase 3 study of lenalidomide and dex versus lenalidomide and dex plus elotuzumab in relapsed refractory myeloma. This is the progression-free survival curves we saw, with an improvement in progression-free survival at 5 months, and you'll see a sustained benefit at 1 year and 2 years with a combination of elo-lendex versus lendex. Again, we have limited data at this point in time, so I'm just using what we have available. And so if you look at the characteristics of the patients at baseline, there's approximately 30% of patients with deletion 17P and 10% with translocation 414 at baseline. And then when you look at the forest plot, down here at the bottom, you'll see in patients with deletion 17P land on the side favoring elo-lendex, similar to patients with 1Q abnormalities as well as translocation 414. So I think if we look at this specifically, there's some data now emerging that elotuzumab may in fact also overcome high-risk disease as well. So just in conclusions, I know I'm running out of time. So a couple of key points here just as takeaway points. Number one, it's key to identify these high-risk patients. I think we've gotten better at it. We focus at baseline risk factors with revised ISSH, so that's critically important to incorporate into our practice now. Don't forget about GEP and LDH. Don't forget host factors, which we have not incorporated so far. And don't forget other clinical features, including early relapse, CNS disease, plasma cell leukemia, extramedullary disease. Don't forget about plasmablastic morphology and c-MYC, which are emerging, as well as chromosome 1 abnormalities. Importantly, when we follow these patients, I think it's also important that we follow these patients differently. And so we'll tend to get much more frequent MRIs for these patients, as well as PET scans to try and identify extramedullary disease in these patients. Getting bone marrow biopsies, because oftentimes these patients will be the ones that will go to oligosecretory or hypersecretory disease. Look for differentials in your peripheral blood, in your CBC for plasma cells, and follow those patients much more closely every 2 months as opposed to every 3 or over 4 months. And finally, these patients need to be treated much more aggressively. So I allude that these patients are like Burkitt's versus a follicular lymphoma. You're going to treat these patients much more aggressively, accept more cytopenias, treat through the cytopenias. And so these patients are treated differently. And when we talk about therapies, bortezomib may overcome translocation 414, again, with induction, consolidation, and maintenance. Lenalidomide, there's no clear data at this point in terms of high-risk myeloma. Pomalidomide, again, not active in translocation 414, but clearly some very nice data with deletion 17P. Carfilzomib, I think the story is emerging here, and from the Endeavor and the Aspire studies, from the subgroup analysis, appears to be active in high risk, but we need a lot more information in terms of deletion 17P, 414, and the various subsets. And so really, so far, the mantra has really been, so far, over the last 5 years, that IMiDs of combinations of IMiDs and proteasome inhibitors are critical both for standard and high-risk disease, including either CPD or RVD. But I think this may be changing now with our new therapies with elotuzumab, specifically with the ELOQUENT 2 study. So this may be bearing true in the promise of immunotherapy and monoclonal antibodies may be able to overcome high-risk disease and be quote-unquote risk-agnostic. And so I think this may change the paradigm, and so it'll be a little controversial here, that this may change the paradigm, that do we need a PI and an IMiD combination for all these patients, and potentially we can get away from that, or is it going to be the combination of a PI, IMiD, plus an elotuzumab? Again, there's more data to come at ASH. The SWOG study of RVD plus or minus ELO, I think, will certainly be helpful, but I think this is a rapidly emerging field, both identifying these patients and managing these patients. I think quite exciting with a few more options in these patients, so I'll stop there.